computers, crawling under tables, lighting candles that are as tall as the sky, thinking if they do this, God will answer. I'm here to tell you, this woman didn't do anything, beloved. It was simply that this God is moved by your pain and the value of one soul. He will do it anyway. If you do anything or nothing, beloved, He will still do it for you. Because you alone are His creation. You alone are valuable. You have the signature of God on your life. If He doesn't do it for you, will He do it for the birds? If He doesn't do it for you, who is He going to do it for? He is your Father. Lift your hands and say, "You are my Father." Shout it out loud. Say, "You are my Father." The value of one soul. There is value in your life. Are you hearing what I'm saying? How many of you understand what I'm saying? Please don't email me. I'm not criticizing. I'm not condemning. I'm just trying to show you that you are so valuable. You don't have to carry a basket of fruits to God. You don't need to give anything to get. Because somebody in Isaiah 53 verse number 4, 2000 years ago, exactly 2700 years ago, before this man ever came through the womb of a virgin woman, the Bible says of this man, there was going to be a man being born of a virgin. When he comes, one of the things he will surely do for his people is found in Isaiah 53:4. Read please. 1, 2, go. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrow. Beloved, God is so moved with your sorrow and your grief that he wanted to put an end to it. That when he sent Jesus, when he went to the cross, he took on himself all our griefs, all our sins, all our sorrows were nailed to that cross that day. For us to say that God is not moved by our pain is to take Isaiah 53 verse 4 out of the Bible. You cannot take Isaiah 53 4 out of the Bible. Why? Because God is moved by people's pain, beloved. He is moved by people's pain that he would send one man in the form of man, God in the form of man, to remove all of humanity. It is pain and grief and sickness and sorrow. His name is Jesus, the Christ of Nazareth. If you just love him, just open your mouth, the circumference of your mouth, beloved, and just say, "Lord, thank you for taking away my grief. Thank you for taking away my sorrow. I believe in a life free from sorrow. I believe a life that I can have a life free from grief." Just tell the Lord, "I believe I can have a life free from grief, free from sorrow." Now, some of you asking, "Then pastor, why are there so many people suffering today? Why are there so many people wounded and broken today? Cannot this God see?" My precious people of God, my precious people of God, my precious people of God, this is why we exist today in this world, the church. That is why we have these meetings, to tell people the message, the good news, the gospel, that there is a God who is moved by their pain. That's why the message has to go to the cancer hospital in Maharagama. That's why the message has to go to the poor in this country. That's why the message has to go to people who are looking for answers. There is a God who is moved by your pain. If you only reach out to him and call his name, he will answer you. He will answer you to show you that he is more real than anything you have gone through in life. And he is greater than anything you have gone through in life. He knows the value of one soul. Hallelujah. He knows the value of one soul. Your soul is valuable to him. Say, "I'm valuable to him." One more time, say, "I'm valuable to him." Beloved, Jesus looks at this mother and tells her, "Don't weep. Don't weep. Don't cry. Don't cry." What audacity. He tells her, "Weep not. Don't cry." He says that. And beloved, he doesn't preach to her a 7-point sermon like me. He says, "Don't cry." And then he goes and he touches the coffin. And he speaks to the young boy as if the young boy is not dead. And says, "Young man, I say unto you, get up. Today, I believe many young people are going to rise in this place by the power of the Holy Spirit. It's going to happen today in Jesus' name. Young man, I say unto you, arise. And this fellow sat up, beloved. He sat up. The Bible says he sat up and Jesus gave him back to the mother. Jesus gave him back to the mother. Mother's tears will be answered today. Every mother in this place who is weeping for children, you will have an answer today in Jesus' name. Maybe you are not hearing what I'm saying. Beloved, you are in the church of the Almighty God. I said every mother that is crying in this place today will have an answer, beloved. Every mother that is weeping here, every young man that is dying in their youthfulness and young adult life, they will rise. Every mother will receive a miracle today. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. What do you think this woman was thinking when the son was returned to the mother? She would have thought, who is this man who gives back to me what I have lost in life? Who is this person who has the power to wipe away my tears and make sure that I will not cry again and will give back what I have lost? There is only one person, the God of all restoration, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the Father of our Lord Jesus. He is here in his spirit today, and he will confirm the word I'm preaching with signs, wonders, and miracles following. The value of one soul, beloved. If you are the only person in this room today, God will restore the things you have lost in life. The Lord will restore the things you have lost in life. Right now, he tells me that many of you are even holding back your tears, even now, beloved, secretly wiping it somewhere in a corner. He sees your tears. He sees your tears. He sees your tears. He's moved by your pain. Say, he's moved by pain. Jesus did three things for this woman. Jesus stopped her tears. Jesus removed her fears. And Jesus restored her cheer in life. Jesus stopped the tear. Jesus removed the fear. And Jesus restored her cheer. He stopped her tears. He removed her fear and restored her cheer. He stopped her tears. He removed her fears and restored her cheer. This is what my God will do for every one of you today in this place. He will stop the tears. He will remove your fears and he will restore your cheer in life. Give him your worship tonight. Give him your praise tonight. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your love. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your love. The power of the Lord is present in this place to heal people. I said the power of the Lord is present in this place. Take advantage of it. Take advantage of it. I said take advantage of the power of the Lord that is present in this place. Jesus was present in Nain. Jesus is present here at BMICH to perform what I have preached, beloved. In his name I stand before you. Luke chapter 5 verse 17 says, the presence and the power of the Lord was there to heal them that were sick. The Lord was present to heal them. The power of the Lord was present to heal them. If you are sick, he will heal you today. If you are weeping, he will stop your tears today. If you are broken, he will fix it today. Whatever it is, there is an answer for everybody in this place. You may say, Pastor, how is this ever going to happen? This is why Jesus didn't explain much to the widow. How many of you are listening to me? Did Jesus explain how he was going to do the miracle to the mother? Answer me, please. Did Jesus explain to the widow, now widow, don't cry. I am going to go and touch your son's coffin and I am going to command him to get up and I'm going to give him back to you. The widow would have laughed at Jesus. So he didn't explain it. She just went and did it. And then she believed. Sometimes God will do it so that you can believe. Sometimes he wants you to believe so that he can do it. But there are moments when he will do it so that you can believe. I believe tonight he is going to do it so you can believe. How many of you are hearing what I'm saying? This is my last verse. Ecclesiastes 11 verse number 5. You don't have to figure out how God is going to do it. He will anyway do it. The Bible says, as you do not know the way of the Spirit, nor how the bones grow in the womb of her that is with child, even so thou knowest not the works of God who maketh all. That's a good place to say amen. How many of you are parents in this place? Can I see your hands? I just feel this in my spirit that it is a special night for parents in this place. I just sense it. If you don't have children, your barren womb will open today in Jesus' name. You will dedicate a child in this very place, beloved, next year by this time. There was a couple at committee room B when we used to have the services there. I don't know whether you remember, Chetana, and I forget the husband's name. They were called forward. I said, the Lord will cause your womb to open and you will dedicate a child next year. Beloved, three weeks ago, this couple had their first child after, I think, 6 years. And they are going to dedicate that little one very soon. He will open your barren womb. Now, you might be having such a tough problem. Listen carefully. You might be having such a big problem that if God was going to tell you how he was going to solve it, you will actually not be able to believe. You understand? That's why sometimes you don't hear God tell you how he is going to do it. Because if he tells you, you will not believe. Maybe you still don't believe that. You want to see it in the Bible? Habakkuk chapter 1 verse 5. Habakkuk chapter 1 verse number 5. I'm going to come back to Ecclesiastes 11 5. When I get off the pulpit, I'm dangerous, beloved. Habakkuk chapter 1 verse number 5. Read it, please. Glory to God. One to go. Behold, everyone together, behold, ye among the heathen, and regard and wonder marvelously. For I will work a work in your days, which you will not believe, though it be told to you. Oh, at least the front row is with me. At least people who are standing, do you understand this English? God is telling Habakkuk, Habakkuk, if I told you what I'm going to do, you will not believe even if I tell you. Some of you are here asking, God, how are you going to do it? God will not tell you. Because if he told you, you will not believe. You're saying, God, I don't have a house. How am I going to build a house? He'll not tell you. Lord, I don't have a child. Now we are married for 12 years or 20 years. How am I going to have a child? He'll not tell you. All he wants you to do is meditate on Ecclesiastes 11:5. 11:5, book of Ecclesiastes, asks us a question. What's the question? Do you know how bones of a child grow inside a mother's womb? Talk to me. Do you know? How many of you had children? Or have children? Okay. Now, did you pray for those ribs to appear? Huh? When the doctor told you that you are pregnant, you started praying. Put your hand around your belly and you said, Father, in the name of Jesus, give this little one all the ribs. Make sure that the right amount of bones are there. Did you pray? You didn't. You just believed that if you just went on a honeymoon and came back. You want me to interpret that in Tamil? If you just went on a honeymoon and you came back and you did your part. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you want children, you got to do your part. Now, it must be told. Can I just... I don't think I can preach it here because... You got to do your part. If you do your part, God will do his. When the seed of the man gets engaged with that which is in the woman, God has put a system in place where even if there was no bones inside the womb to give the child, suddenly as the child grows, the bones start to appear. My question to you, how did those bones get there? From where did it get there? Who put it there? Who decided the length of the bones? The Bible says, even as you do not know that, you do not know how God's going to do the miracle for you. But bottom line, he will do it. That's all that matters.